the book of Esther, chapter 4, verses 14, where it goes as, "For if you keep silent at such a time as this, relief and deliverance will rise for the Jews from another quarter, but you and your father's family will perish. Who knows? Perhaps you have come to royal dignity for just at this time." Then Esther said in reply to Mordecai, "Go gather all the people to be found in Susa and hold fast a fast on my behalf and neither eat nor drink for 3 days and nights. And I and my maids will also fast and do so. And after that I will go to the king, though if it is against the Lord, and if I perish, I perish." Mordecai then went away and did everything that Esther had ordered him to. The word of the Lord. How many of you know the book of Esther? As children, we read this book, and most of the time when we read the book of Esther, there's one thing very rather prominent through this book is that it is a book talking about a woman in a time when the Jews were in Persia, and she was raised by, there are very three main characters in this particular book, okay, and one is the king himself, then you have a queen Vashti who doesn't obey, so is banished. Then Esther, who's sent by Mordecai, who's adopted by her uncle Mordecai, and then is sent into the king's, not a harem but a concubine, and but he's, when the king, when Vashti denies him, he asks for all the beautiful women to be bought, and he makes Esther the queen. Things are good for Esther. But there was one villain, like in every Hindi movie, you have a villain named Haman. And he was against the Jews. But Mordecai was a gatekeeper. A gatekeeper's job is one to take care of things. He overhears the conversation in the palace about murdering the king, which is reported to the king, and so the king is saved. But Mordecai, enemy was Haman. Haman wanted all the Jews to bow down and do things like that, but they were very faithful to their God. They say that we will not bow down to anybody but the Lord. For them, God was Yahweh. And so many times in our lives, we are faced with compromises. How many of you face this thing of compromise? If I don't compromise, I want to be accepted. Am I right or wrong? It's a challenge every woman, and today I'm talking to a group of women. And so it's a challenge every woman, but even man faces. I have to make a compromise. If I have to fit in here, I compromise. If I don't compromise, I'm out. And so this 14th verse, 4 verse 14, is one of the most important verses. Because Mordecai sends a message to Esther, because Esther is very upset, he is mourning with sackcloth and ashes, and she sends him clothes. And he says, "No, today if you are the queen, you're there not because God put you accidentally but providentially to save your people. So you need to go and speak to the king." But you know, in those days, nobody could gain an audience with the king, okay, just like that. Directly, if you went, you were murdered. You killed. But Esther tells him something which is very beautiful. "You want me to do something like this? Proclaim a fast. I will fast, my people, my maids will fast, and you fast with me." My dear sisters in the Lord, you know, before taking any decision in life, be bold yet wise. And what? One of the greatest moments, that's why I told you, this is the time of Lent that we have called you here. One of the greatest weapons we have today is fasting. You won't die, I will tell you honestly. If you miss one meal, nothing will happen. I have missionary friends who are eating only one meal for the last, I don't know, 20, 25 years. They are eating only one of them, I just met recently, is 92, and is still radiant. We gave up because of seeing poverty around. Of course, not everyone is called for that. But I've seen certain graces in him which are beyond. But today, generally, when something goes wrong, what do? We start, we get so worried, we get so, and we eat more than what we are supposed to eat. And people tell you, you need to have at least 6 meals a day. If you don't have 6 meals, you know. I'm trying to tell you, but a little bit of my own life. My profession, I was a fashion designer. I had my own office in Bombay. I was miraculously healed of 17 years of an illness when I was going in for my second paralytic stroke. Down the journey, I met the Lord. I received my healing 100%. I was healed of every blood, the clots, the back three, this put in order and everything. And then I was called to serve the Lord. Okay? And so to cut this long story short, after 9 months of prayer and discernment, I sold everything and I came to this very seminary and studied God's word. So I always say, today I don't fashion clothes but souls for Jesus. And today what you are here in this crowd is for all for the greater glory of God, that you're listening to the word. And the courage that I received to go ahead and do came out of a 40-day fast that I was called after I received my healing. I'm still grateful to that sister who told me, Anastasia, rarely do we see people get 100% healing. Generally it's a 70, 80 and maybe 10% they struggle. And I said, I really don't know, but she says, will you fast for 40 days? And I told her, what does it include? She said, just 12 hours without a meal. But fasting is not the only thing. You'll have to fast and pray. And during those 40 days, of course, the team supported me. I'm still with the prayer group called Jesus the Real Man. One of the brothers was very close to me. He said, Anastasia, at any stage, if you feel that you can't continue, please stop. But those 40 days, not only of prayer and fasting, I got to know Jesus. Because my hours of prayer those times was at 3 early morning, 3 o'clock. It was not very easy at times because we came from the world, and when the world, 3 o'clock is here. But I learned to listen. What Maria shared with you was Isaiah 30, 21. There's a voice that tells you go right or go left. But to listen to that voice, you have to be empty of yourself. If Esther wanted to listen to what God had to tell her so that she could save her people, the first thing Esther did was to empty herself. Fasting from food is a very small thing, actually, in the Old Testament, and even today there are many who fast, but it also creates a hunger for God. It creates such a hunger for God that you want to know what's His will in your life. My dear sisters in Christ, you know, when you're sitting here, most of you have come here. But I want to tell you, today you've not come here because you have a problem. My prayer is you've come here because you want to be special. You want to be that Esther, you want to be that Deborah, you want to be a blessed mother who's yes, has brought us salvation. Her example is one of the best we have. And so you want to be somebody, a woman of excellence. I'm deeply blessed to listen to so many testimonies, one testimony after the other, coming and sharing. But someday each one of you will stand here and testify what the Lord has done. You know, because it takes great courage to come up here. How many of you grow have fear when you wake in the morning? How many of you have fear? Okay? You get up with fear. We are paralyzed with fear. Okay, sometimes some situation comes and we are paralyzed with fear. But the Bible encourages to trust and have confidence in God. So how can you have this kind of trust? How can you have this kind of confidence? I realized when you are paralyzed with fear, what happens to you? You don't respond to anybody, you just react. So the person that comes in front becomes your punching bag. Am I right or wrong? The person who comes in, because you cannot communicate, you're frightened, you're scared what will go wrong. And I want to share with you a testimony which will bring home what I'm trying to tell you. You know, when I was caring for this very same child that is sitting here and playing the keyboard, you know, I was publicly illiterate, so I had to come here to the seminary to study. But in the first year itself, after my healing, I conceived this child who's playing the keyboard. And father asked me one question. He said, you know, Anastasia, how will this child be? And I said, father, not like me. Illiterate. I said, the child will know more of the world than I know of the world. And the other day she was telling, Mama, you remember every morning and Sunday morning you would read the Bible. And then what happens? I went to church and this one particular priest, some of you know him, Father Aaron, he used to throw chocolates at all the children. And she says, I used to get all the chocolates, I used to feel so happy because we have read the word and gone. But during the time I was carrying her, my husband has a business, we have a transport business. And we had a severe, at that time, extortion was a big thing in the city of Mumbai. And they came to the office and took him. And my boy from the office called and said, Madam, please do not send him to the office. But in that time, a sister of mine from the prayer group called me up and she was talking to me about the program that we are having. And I said, they have taken Flavian from the office. She says, what do you want to do? She says, let's pray. Let's pray. And we started praying non-stop. I had two children then. I got them into the prayer room. We have a small prayer room in the house and we started praying. Within another 1 hour's time, I got a call saying that I am coming home. And I said, what happened? He says, no, only the money that was on me is taken, but they have given me a deadline. And when he came home, I was thanking and praising God. But in those 30 days after that, I was only told one thing. One was go to the Blessed Sacrament and sit before the Lord. And the second thing was praise Psalm 70. And during that time, I was told now fast for 30 days, which is not normal. I'm telling you, it's not normal. And I started fasting for 30 days. And what was the Spirit telling me? You will fast for 30 days, not because of your husband, but because of the families that are going through this problem in this city of Mumbai. And every morning I said, Lord, you are telling me to pray for others, but what am I going through? And I said, no, you just pray for these people. And as I started praying for these people, on the 30th day, something telling me now fast for 2 more days. And you know, honestly speaking, when you fast for 30 and 32 days, it doesn't make much of a difference. Because there's a kind of a grace. And as I was fasting for another 3 days more, even today we go for the 6 o'clock mass, most of the time, unless I come late from a program. And I was asked to buy the newspaper. So I picked up the newspaper. And on the newspaper, right on the headlines was that particular person, it was a group, was shot abroad by the police and this whole problem came to an end. Let's give our Lord a mighty hand of praise. But during that time, I learned something, you know, trust only in the Lord. Because the world, including family at time, told me that people have prayed, you will have to pray. I said, today if I can call on a phone and say, give me this much amount of money or else you're short, so easy. And many of the people, because they were in fear. But it never stops with what they asked you. It continues. So each one of us here, from the book of Esther, we will learn some things. And that I'd like to tell you. From an orphan, she became the queen. God can take you from this nobody to make you somebody for him. He doesn't need your qualifications. He doesn't need anything. He only needs your availability. Like Fiona is my childhood friend, and she'll tell you sometimes, the only thing that I learned was basic maths, and then I did designing. So the only thing I knew was numbers and sketches. I knew nothing else. And if today I'm ministering God's word, it's not because I'm extra brilliant or anything, it's because of the Spirit. And I'm trying to tell each one of you, from any nobody, he can make you somebody. The next thing about this, there was a plot to wipe out the race. That plot put Esther in something what would put anyone in a dilemma. Because what does I tell, sir? If you are silent, your entire family will be wiped out. You heard this? Sometimes we have to stand for the truth, and to stand for the truth, what happens? If you chicken out, nothing can happen. Do not be afraid. So, Esther is faced with this problem of going and facing the king without an appointment. She can face death, but she does not give in to what her fears are. Because there will always be triumph over opposition. Believe me or not, if you are not being opposed, you are not heading for victory. Especially when you do the right thing, you want a pat on your back, you will not get it. You will not get it. And most of us want everybody to say, yes. It's just the opposite. We are not told to go through life without opposition. You know, an ECG which is straight is what? You're dead. Also in our spiritual life, if it's a straight line, you are dead. So, but the book of Galatians chapter 5 verse 16, it says, so I say, walk by the Spirit and do not gratify the desires of the flesh. Focus on the Holy Spirit, what He is telling you, because without no challenge, there is no change. Unless you are challenged, you will not change. To be a woman of excellence, you have to have some kind of change. And the change is not the people around you. It is you change. I learned this from a confessor who just died. 18 years he molded me to come where I am. He used to always tell me, Anastasia, people don't change, things don't change, you change. It was very difficult to hear. Father, I'm praying, nothing is happening, nothing will happen. Has anything happened to you? So also with fast, he used to tell me, is the fast making you more tolerant or is it making you angry? So we need to ask, focus on the Spirit. Acknowledge in that we lack courage is the first step to recognizing it. If you say, I have no fear, you're in denial. Acknowledging that I cannot face anything that is ahead of me is the first step for going to it. Because see, I tell you now, we go on mission sometimes to Northeast, okay? My mother gets very upset when we go because my phone doesn't work, okay? And we are scared sometimes because you don't know. The land has wonderful things happening around, okay? But I always tell the Lord, I have no courage to go. But if you have the grace to empower me with the strength, can I go? Because initially when I used to go on mission, I used to be sent alone. And I used to find it very strange. I used to say, why are you sending me alone? And I would always hear this voice, you are not alone. I am with you, but I can't see you. I am with you. So acknowledging is the first step. I know many people say, no, I'm very brave. When you put those people to the test, they will be the first ones to run away. Second thing about this is, recognize that God is all powerful, that He has promised He will never leave you nor forsake you. This is not my words. This is the word of book of Hebrews. Okay? He will never forsake you. He'll hold you by your hand and take you through. I'm telling each one of you here, please say, He'll never forsake me. Please say that. The last thing is, go to Him in prayer and fasting to seek His will. Don't try to do this on your own. The word of God in John chapter 15 verse 5 says, I am the vine, you are the branches. If you abide in me and I abide in you, you'll bear much fruit. For apart from me you can do nothing. So God is a rewarder of those who seek Him diligently. You know what? One thing remember. What Paul says in this letter, I love to read. It says, brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet taken hold of. But one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining to the goal that lies ahead. You know, whatever has happened in your life today, please forget it. If it's not good to remember, it's not worth it. Leave it behind. But strain to the goal that lies ahead. You know, all of us, when we run, if you're a runner, you know what I'm saying. How does the runner run? Backward or forward? Always forward. So strain to the goal that lies ahead. Because there's a tremendous victory when you know Jesus. God will ultimately bring you triumph over evil. You'll have courage in the face of danger. You'll have courage in the face of danger. You may face many challenging situations, but you will have the courage. People will come and tell you, how come you're so bold? You know in your heart, you're not bold, everything is going like this. But the Lord is with you. He will give you the strength to do what He wants you to do. He'll give you the strength, like I heard one of them say that, He'll tell you when to keep quiet. You know, when you experience Jesus, not in big things, my dear sisters. Miracles are always there. My 17 years of an illness is a big miracle. I couldn't carry a baby more than 2 kgs away. I'd be paralyzed. I carried 2 kids. One is Simone and there's one more after this. I have 4 children. And I have Celeste who's also with me. It's my sister's daughter. So actually I have a house of plenty. Okay? Now one has gone abroad. He's gone to Australia to study. But yet my house is always filled with people. So He'll give you courage to do things which you will never be able to do. Not on your own strength. So, and not to be silent in the presence of evil. If you see something going wrong, don't say it is somebody else's business. It is our business. Don't say this is not my child. It is our children. Our children need us today. They are waiting for that tap. They are waiting for them. Come and tell them, you're good, you're beautiful, you'll do well in life. Most of the time you go on correcting. Huh? I'll tell you when to be silent. When you want to say the most rudest thing, God bite my tongue. Now what are the biggest things we ladies have? What are the biggest things we have? Come on. We don't have big tongues, but we have power over it to bless or to curse. It goes for men too. James chapter 3 says, with this I can bless and with this I can curse. But we call to bless because we are in the name of Jesus. We are called to give life. Everything that you say will happen. If you say your child is not good, your child will always have this thing, I am not good enough. Till she meets her or his heavenly father who tells him or her you're special. So silent in the presence of evil is something. I can give any testimonies in the years where we have supported people who have had on the verge of breaking down because no family support. Even when your children make mistakes, please tell them I'll stand by you. I'll stand by you. We all made mistakes. All of us have made mistakes. And our Heavenly Father never gave us a check saying, I will not be with you. He still says, I am with you. So when you read the book of Esther, there is one thing that comes to our mind. And that is this. That Esther renews our belief in a God who acts, a God of history who continues to do miracles and is with His people forever. God has made a covenant with us. A covenant that cannot be broken. You and I were bought with the blood of the Lamb. The Holy Father was talking in this encyclical on Lent. He said that, you know, the greatest need today in the church or to us is to build a relationship with Jesus. During this holy season of Lent, We pray that we build our relationship with Jesus, so that we may connect with Him, to be in love with Him forever.